I think that for most programmers on a daily basis, it's going to be auto for declaring variables and also probably lambda expressions. Those are the things that are most visible to people. I think that actually a more fundamental improvement is the support for concurrency, which didn't exist at all in C++ 98. And that particular new feature is not terribly visible to programmers in a lot of ways because it mostly affected compiler writers. But in terms of the most widespread impact on people, it's probably going to be the one that makes the most difference. Move semantics obviously is very important as well. But I think the concurrency is a little bit more fundamental from that perspective. A couple of things come to mind. One of them is both are based on ideas that I think are reasonable ideas. Then the question becomes, were they executed properly? One of them is what's usually referred to as uniform initialization. And the idea was that we would have a single syntax for initializing everything. And that particular promise has not been achieved because there's some ambiguities in certain cases, and there are situations where you can't use brace initialization when you have to use a different form. So I think there's been some controversy there about whether that should have been implemented in the particular way that it was. And the other thing that comes to mind is async and futures, which is a great idea. You simply say, I want to run this thing asynchronously, and you don't have to think about it at all, but then they did some interesting things regarding the specification of the behavior of futures that come from async, and there's been a lot of controversy on the committee about whether they should change that or whether they should replace it. And it's my impression that there's a pretty reasonable chance that starting in C++ 17 there will be some new feature which will probably replace that. The first thing I want to say about the standardization committee, and I'm not on the standardization committee, I should clarify, is that they have a very difficult job. The material is extremely technically demanding. So I have a tremendous amount of respect for the people on the committee and for the work that they do, because it's not easy work. And even the simplest things require an enormous amount of effort. Having said that, I think that it shows sometimes that this is definitely a committee that is designing the language as opposed to a single person or small group of people with a clear vision for where the language wants to go. And that shows up we have, for example, three different ways of specifying alignment, but we have a relatively impoverished standard library. So I think the committee overall does a reasonable job. I wish that they did things in some ways a little bit differently, and I think that probably they wish in some ways that I was maybe a member of the committee trying to get those things done. So that's my feeling about the committee. I think the committee is a reasonable way to bring lots of parties together. To be honest, I don't think that Bjarne has any desire to be the person who makes all of the decisions. The advantage of a person who makes all of the decisions is that they can then have a clear vision and they can really implement that clear vision. And there's no one who plays that role in C++, and I don't know if anybody could play that role in C++. It's a little bit different from lots of other languages because it's very cross-platform, so you're dealing with lots and lots of different operating systems, lots of compiler vendors. There's not a lot of other languages which there will be, say, four major compilers that run on different platforms. And also just the range of applications, especially when you start thinking about the impact of C++ on embedded systems, where it's quite an important programming language. They have really different views of the world in some cases. So it would be nice if there were, like I said, a sort of a clearer vision by a single person, but I don't think that's going to be happening at C++. I think that the chances of any decision that would break backward compatibility is virtually zero, because I think that one of the great strengths of C++ is that it does have tremendous backward compatibility. So there are billions of lines of code. Some of it was written 20 or 25 years ago, and it would be a really significant departure for the committee to decide that they don't want to preserve people's investment. So I don't ever expect that to happen. I think everybody agrees that the standard library is too small, and it needs to be a lot larger. And I think that historically we got to where we are because people focused on the language and they said, once you have a suitable language, then you can build great libraries. And we've been waiting 20 years for people to build great libraries. And the thing is, they have built great libraries. I mean, there are some really nice libraries out there. There aren't as many as we would like. One of the reasons for that, though, is that unlike, for example, Java or C Sharp, basically, there's no corporate sponsor behind this language, and it's a cross-platform language. So you're basically looking for volunteers to put together libraries and then make them available to everybody else. And a fair number of people have done that, but they're just sort of spread around. The Standardization Committee now has started taking a much more serious look at this, and so I think that there is a concerted effort to try to, number one, get more libraries developed, and number two, take the existing libraries that exist at places like Boost and at Microsoft and at Facebook and at Adobe and lots of other places, and bring them together under a license that everybody can live with and put them in a place where everybody can find. There's a definite effort that is being expended to make that happen. But there's no question that the standard library is much smaller and has fewer features than we would prefer. I believe that the standard library should be larger. I think it should offer some really basic functionality. For example, it is 2014. There is no concept in the standard library of putting anything on a screen anywhere. There's no concept of graphics. That's silly. There is no concept of the internet. There is no concept of a URL. There is no concept of a URI. For that matter, there is no concept really of a file system. These are all, in my mind, obvious places where a standard library would really be helpful. And incidentally, there are also places where the Standardization Committee is actively working to address those particular issues. But I'm inclined to say that if there is a common need that many developers are going to have, there's just a lot of mileage to be gained by putting it in a standard form so everybody knows how it works. It would certainly be convenient. Whether that's going to ultimately take place, and if so, what form it's going to take, I don't know. But that would be consistent with this idea of going out to people who've already got existing libraries and then saying, okay, great, now we know what all the libraries are. If we can unify them under some kind of common acceptable license, now we can start putting them in one location where people can look up them and search for them and things like that. So I think that the foundation is being laid to make that possible. Whether it will take place remains to be seen. Well, let me answer the last question first, actually. It's interesting because 10 years ago, everybody was saying, in 10 years, everyone's going to be using managed languages. And managed languages are very important, but certainly it's not the case that everybody is using them. So I don't think in 10 years that everyone will be using managed languages. I think that C++ is going to remain an extremely important language for production use, simply because if your goal is to get the maximum amount of performance out of the machine, if that's what is most important to you, I really think that even these days, the primary competitors are C and C++. Those are pretty much your choices. And C++ is just a much more expressive language. I have to say that I'm not a C programmer. I've never really been a C programmer. But I think that just the simple notion of destructors is so unbelievably powerful that I, as a C programmer, I would consider moving to C++ just so I could compile and get destructors. And obviously, there's a lot more to it than that. In terms of your original question about choosing between these various languages, you know, fundamentally, to me, that's a management or a higher level engineering decision. You have to take into account, what do we want to accomplish? What's the goal of the software? Who are the people we have available? What existing infrastructure do we have? And you're trying to optimize for a lot of things simultaneously. I don't offer advice on that question. My job is to understand C++ and help engineers use it better. My job is not to try to tell people whether they should use it or should not use it. I don't follow the mobile market that closely. It is my understanding that a lot of the mobile platforms originally said, okay, everything will be programmed only in Java. And they said, well, okay, now we're going to have a backdoor and let you program in C++. And then they said, okay, only Objective-C. Oh, okay, now here's a backdoor. You can also use C++. So I think there's a demand on the part of the people programming those platforms to have native languages. And so from that perspective, I think actually the percentage of programs running C++ on mobile platforms has actually increased because developers have been insisting on it. The other thing, though, is I think an awful lot of mobile stuff essentially acts as a front end to computation that's taking place in the cloud. And so I think if you're thinking mobile, you also have to take into account, okay, well, what's running on the servers which are servicing these mobile devices? And C++ is certainly very strong in server farms where you're trying to get the maximum possible dollars out of the servers that you have available. So I think it's probably going to remain stronger in servers than it is on the mobile devices, but there's certainly no reason it can't be run on the mobile devices. The choice for C++ was actually made for me in some sense. I started programming a really long time ago, about 1972. My first language was BASIC, which was pretty common in 1972. But in 1985, I went to graduate school to work on a PhD in computer science. And one of the things that I had to do as a graduate student was to act as a teaching assistant for some courses. And the course I was assigned to act as a teaching assistant for was a course on software engineering. And the professor who was teaching that course said, okay, I want to have a decent software engineering language, and C++ was the language that he chose, and so I had to learn C++. This was actually a couple of years later. So I didn't choose C++. I ended up working in a course where C++ was the programming language, and so that's how I started first programming in it. Yeah, well, that was kind of an accident, actually, to be honest. First, I learned C++, and then there was a request from a company for me to develop a C++ training course, which then could be used for training industrial clients. And it was an interesting offer because I was a graduate student, so I was working hard and not making a lot of money. And they basically said, how would you like to write down some stuff that you already know, and we'll pay you a whole bunch of money? And I said, well, that sounds fairly attractive. So that was how I got into C++. And then from there, I started teaching classes. And then I wrote my first book, which was Effective C++, which was pretty popular. And it was funny because I remember about 1991, 1992, and my wife said, well, how long are you going to be doing this? And I said, it's a programming language. They don't last very long. So, you know, 5 years tops. It can't go any longer than that. And so here we are 25 years later, and we're still doing it. So it was sort of an accident. There's a couple of differences. One of them is just by its nature. I mean, a book is a larger scope thing. You have to have a bigger vision of what you're trying to achieve. And you have more space in which to achieve it. So that's part of it. The other way you can look at it is that if you have a small idea, you don't want to write a book, you want to write an article. So it kind of depends on how much you have to say. The other thing that's kind of interesting to me about writing articles versus writing books, at least my perspective, was that when you write an article, it's in a magazine, and so you're trying to get people's attention and hold it for a short period of time. And there are certain techniques that you use to do that. So you might be a little more controversial, you might be a little bit more conversational or confrontational. And I used to think of it, it's like if you're standing in line at the supermarket and you fall into conversation with the person next to you, it's a short conversation. So there's certain kinds of things that you can do. Writing a book is a much longer contact with readers. And I think of this as it's like being in an airplane next to somebody on a 6-hour flight. You don't want to sit next to somebody who's controversial and who's provoking you for 6 hours. That's really annoying. And that was one of the things I found in one of my books was that I actually had to sit back and rewrite my second book because it sounded too much like a magazine article. And when you read 50 pages of it, it was, oh, this is driving me crazy. I hate this guy. To me, those are the two things that come to mind is sort of the scope of what you're trying to say and the tone that you adopt when you say it. There are some differences when you go from country to country because there are some cultural differences, in particular having to do with confronting a speaker or asking questions of a speaker. And in the United States and in England, actually and in Germany in my experience, those people are not shy about saying, well, wait a minute, that doesn't seem right at all. So, you know, you're going to have to really justify that. And then there are some other places where people are more, they don't want to offend you, they don't want to be problematic. Having said that, my experience is you can sort of break through that if you try to engage people, especially if you are at a place for more than 1 or 2 days. They get to know you. And at least the people who tend to come to the kind of presentations that I give, which is a self-selected group, those people, after you break through that, they're all very smart, they have really good insights, and I actually don't find significant differences in the developers in terms of the way that they think, in terms of their ability to comprehend the material or even to formulate questions. So my experience is that every place I go, I'm really lucky, I'm dealing with really smart people who are really working on interesting problems, and it's a challenge for me to keep up with them, and it's also a pleasure to be able to try. Not very much, no. I decided many years ago that I'm not a developer. I actually was a software developer a long time ago, and I wrote a reasonable amount of software when I was a graduate student. But I used to be embarrassed about that. And I used to think, well, you know, I'm talking to these people who program, and I don't really program anymore. But that's not my job. My feeling about it is that for the people who are responsible for producing software, their job is to deliver a product, and they have to master the tool, they have to master the APIs, but they actually have to get something productive done. And they're too busy to keep track of everything that's going on in the world of C++ and software engineering. My job is to keep track of all that stuff that's going on and then try to condense it down into articles or books or presentations that these developers can then consume in a relatively small amount of time. So I'm not a developer anymore. I don't really do any serious coding, but I'm not embarrassed about it any longer because I've decided that the job that I do, I think, is a reasonable job.